colleague of ours, Mr. Wagner, taught me that an academic needs to be able to give a 50-minute talk at the drop of a hat. If I don't know how to do that by now, I'm done.
That's the 49.
Okay, so it's already started. So Mr. Rosolino Candela, who is our speaker tonight, already started giving his conference. But let's do this. Quick, short introduction. So I have Professor Dragoș Paul Aligică, who is going to be the moderator, and I'm going to quickly turn over the speech to him. To thank him for having this idea of inviting Professor Rosolino Candela to talk to us about a subject that is hot. Relevant, and thank you for doing this for us. So on behalf of the Mises Institute, I'm very happy to host this talk. We have a tradition in gathering here and offering these talks that we call Mises Evenings. So I'm really glad to have the opportunity to host another one. And with this said, Professor Aligică, please introduce our guest. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Tudor, and thank you so much, Mrs. Institute, for organizing this, for inviting us, and also for asking me to be the moderator and facilitator of this conversation. And I'd like to emphasize that the key word here is conversation. So we have plotted a little bit before the event, and basically, this is what is going to happen. I've asked Rosolino to give us a brief on academic standards presentation, about 30, maybe 40 minutes or so. But keep in mind that from time to time, we may be able or willing to interrupt him to ask questions in clarification. So it could be a presentation, but from time to time, if necessary, I or anybody in the room might ask a question in clarification in order to be all of us on the same page when it comes to the conversation. And then, towards the end of the PowerPoint presentation and towards the end of the presentation, we are going to slide slowly in a full conversation involving everybody. But in order to be an organized conversation, like I said, I'd be the moderator or the facilitator, and therefore I'll be the focal point of it. And we are going to use a sort of signaling system, which is traditional. Raise your hand like this if you want to make a point which is different from the point which is ongoing in the conversation, and signal to me like this if you want to make a point which is about the topic which is on the table at the moment of you raising the hand. So these are the basic rules of the conversation, though this is the setup. I'm not going to spend much time talking about our guest speaker. You are here because you have already done your homework and you know of his background and you know of his accomplishments as a scholar. For the students here, it's important to know that he is the person who is actually in charge with admissions and scholarships at Mercator Center. So it's important to raise your hands and signal and ask nice questions. So we'll keep you in mind for the next cycle of fellowships. And going to say something that probably you are unable to get in your Google search of his name, which is the fact that Rosolino is more than 50% a Romanian. He's basically here in both a sort of professional trip, visiting with us, but also family. Trip is one of his first vacations in I don't know how many years, Rosolino.
Oh, in Romania or in general?
In general.
Since the honeymoon.
Since the honeymoon,
yeah. Listen.
And the honeymoon was like, what?
12 years ago.
12 years ago, so listen to that. Also, he has a son, and his son's
name. Two
sons, but his youngest son, right? Yes, is my favorite. yes, this is my favorite, and his name is Spiridon. Spirus, Spirache, right? Victorash. So these are things that you don't know about Rosolino. That's why I'm saying that he's more than 50% Romanian. So we should be treating him like that. The traditional way the Romanians are treating other Romanians. Now, briefly about the topic. As you know, it's a fascinating topic. It's an ongoing follow-up of probably the most important debate in the history of social sciences in the 20th century, and maybe in the history of social sciences ever, the economic calculation debate. And as you could see, the debate was so important and the topic was so relevant that even today, after the cybernetics revolution, we are still talking about it, and we are rediscovering the debate as being extraordinarily important. And the entire technical apparatus, conceptual apparatus, which has been created during the debate and the aftermath of that debate, continues to be the most important and powerful tool helping us to unlock and understand institutional, political developments, economic and technological developments, which were not even dreamt of at the beginning of the 20th century, when for the first time the economic calculation debate raged between socialists and people who were skeptical about the possibility and feasibility of socialism. But here we are today, we are talking about techno-socialism, and I'm going to let Rosolino take it from here, and we are going to follow the rules that I have suggested. So, Rosolino, please.
Well, first of all, I want to thank you all for being here. Thank you very much for those warm and gracious remarks and the invitation by the Mises Institute to give this talk with all of you here today. And I look forward to the conversation, as Professor Aligică had mentioned. Just a few opening remarks about what I'm going to be talking about today. The title of my talk comes from an article based on joint work that I have done with Peter Becky. The title itself comes from an article that's now published in the Journal of Economic Behavior and Organization. But this point that I'm making also draws from other work that we've done together. And more importantly, as Professor Aligică had mentioned in his opening remarks, this is not just a debate that's being held amongst academics. It's a new debate one in which computer scientists and businessmen are engaging in the United States. I don't think it's hard to stress, particularly in this audience, that we've had a whole generation since the fall of the Berlin Wall that has lived without any living memory of socialism in Eastern and Central Europe. And so this is why that these arguments, the arguments both of Mises and Hayek, and the impossibility of economic calculation under socialism, needs to be rearticulated for each generation, particularly in this context, where the notion that increased computerization, namely in the fields of big data and artificial intelligence, will give us a set of means by which to solve the calculation problem. And in fact, this point has been raised by a very famous entrepreneur that you may all know, Jack Ma, the founder of the big firm Alibaba. Now, here's the quote that he states. He says, "Over the past 100 years, we have come to believe that the market economy is the best system. But in my opinion, there will be a significant change in the next 3 decades, and the planned economy will become increasingly big." Here's the key point in the quote, which is framing the discussion for today. Why is this so? Because with access to all kinds of data, the key word here is data, we may be able to find the invisible hand of the market. The fundamental argument that I want to make today is that proponents of what is known as techno-socialism, a term that is coined by Richard King and Petty, who I'm going to be talking about in a moment, the fundamental reason why techno-socialism can never be used as a set of means to solve the calculation problem, to create a sensible allocation of the means of production, namely capital goods, to their most valued uses, is because of a conflation with the computation of data, which is information that is given, that's the Latin verb, given, and the conflation of that with the discovery of contextual knowledge. That's the key point that I want to make today. There's an important distinction between the computation of information as data and the discovery of contextual knowledge. So the main argument I want to make is that although techno-socialism may appear to be something new under the sun, it is actually new wine in an old bottle, because it's simply a repetition of an argument that had been stated going back 55 years ago in an article, or I should say a book chapter, posthumously published for a socialist economist named Maurice Dobb by the economist Oscar Lange. Oscar Lange, as you may well know, was one of the market socialists who had countered Mises' objection to the possibility of economic calculation under socialism. So the point I'm trying to make is that given we can situate King and Brett King and Richard Petty's arguments in the context of Lange's argument, what I am suggesting is that they are saying nothing new. They are simply restating the point, which is they are taking implicitly, though not explicitly in their book, they are taking implicitly the outcome of a market where full and available information is reflected in prices, in which individuals passively respond to them as if they are constraints in order to solve the calculation problem. But individuals are not price takers. They are price makers. They generate prices in the context of exchange. And here is the key statement that Lange makes in that famous book chapter called The Computer and the Market. He said, "Let us put the simultaneous equations on an electronic computer, and we shall obtain the solution in less than a second." That is, if we can set up a program, a set of parameters of differential equations, and we feed the data to a computer, then the necessary output that is generated by that computer will be able to deliver the outcome of the market process consistent with competitive equilibrium. And he says, the market process, which is necessary tant et mons, appears old-fashioned. Indeed, it may be considered as a computing device of the pre-electronic age. Now, let me just stop for a moment. It's an interesting turn of phrase. Because the word itself, in the original French, tant et mons, I apologize, I'm from New York, so my French is very bad. It literally means groping in an uncertain world. But here the word is being used as if you are gathering relevant data, as if it's a known unknown. But the nature, the true nature of a tant et mons process in the market is a groping towards an uncertain world where there are unknown unknowns to which entrepreneurs respond based on profit loss signals. Now, what is techno-socialism? Let's define our terms for a moment. Now, in many ways, I am making the argument that King and Petty implicitly are restating the market socialist argument, the notion that Lange and Abelerner argued that we can use the model of general competitive equilibrium, which is the outcome of a market process, and utilize that model in order to facilitate a trial and error process consistent with the market. However, if you read King and Petty's book, it presents a black box, very much in the same way in which Marx in Das Kapital gives us a definition of socialism without a blueprint of what it will actually look like. And in this way, King and Petty are defining it not as a political movement, but simply as a social outcome. That's the key word I want to hone in on, outcome, based on the long-term sustainability, equality, and the advancement of humanity as a whole. Now, the means by which to achieve this outcome, according to King and Petty, is the advanced computational power of artificial intelligence. and that this will give a burst of productivity that will outpace a market economy, right? A market economy under its given conditions. Now, the point that I want to stress is that, like Mises in opposing Otto Neurath in the calculation argument, the point here is not to challenge the stated ends that King and Petty are establishing. We want a world that's sustainable. We want a world that's more equitable. We want a world that's more productive. However, what we're going, taking that as given, like the Mises and Hayek's calculation argument, we can challenge the means by which to achieve that end. Namely, that in the absence of private property in the means of production, then these set of ends are incoherent with that set of means, that is, an abolition of private property. Now, Mises, as you may know, had made his arguments in the context of the establishment of wartime socialism, both in Austria-Hungary and in Bolshevik Russia. And in that, so Mises in his argument was not simply engaging in being an armchair economist. He was tackling a real-world policy issue of that time. And as I am doing so today, he also was not challenging the ends of socialism. What he did was, in his argument against Otto Neurath, the Marxist economist to whom he was responding, he was challenging the means by which to achieve that end. And in doing so, he set up the strongest case possible, the strongest case possible for a socialist order. He assumed, for the sake of argument, a free market in consumer goods. Because under the definition of socialism, we're simply talking about an abolition of private property in the means of production. He also assumed perfect motivation or benevolence. So let's assume Mother Teresa, everyone here knows who Mother Teresa was, right? Okay, we're assuming Mother Teresa is the central planner. So this individual, it has the best motivation. They are incentivized in order to deliver a allocation of resources that is consistent with maximizing consumer welfare and advancing economic productivity. He also had assumed complete access to technical knowledge, technological knowledge of the time. But in a syllogistic fashion, what did Mises argue? He argued without private property in the means of production, you don't have a market in the means of production. And if you don't have a market, you don't have exchange. What are prices but exchange ratios? They're the terms in which two goods are exchanged. And without prices, you will be unable to calculate the opportunity costs of capital goods in their most valued consumer uses. Now, an example to illustrate this is a railroad. From a technological standpoint, we all know, using knowledge of physics and chemistry, that platinum is the most durable, long-lasting metal in which to build a railroad. But we don't build railroads with platinum. We build them with iron. But why do we build them with iron? We build them because they're cheaper. How do we know that? We know that because the price reflects that, right? But how do we know that? We know that because there is active bidding between consumers for iron and platinum in alternative consumer uses. So what is the point I want to hone in on? And I'm going to harp on this over and over again. Note here what I'm saying is that the nature of the knowledge about whether platinum or iron is scarcer or not, platinum being scarcer relative to iron, is not simply that the knowledge that is embedded in those prices, it's not simply that it's tacit. It's not simply that it's inarticulate. It's not simply that it's difficult to reconstruct those prices. It's that those prices are context specific. What that implies is, outside the context of exchange, entrepreneurs actively bidding for platinum or iron. That knowledge simply does not exist. It simply doesn't exist to anyone. So if you want to, even if you are Mother Teresa, and you want to know how to build a railroad that is consistent with increasing economic productivity, without the knowledge that is embodied in the exchange process, it's impossible to achieve that, even if you are perfectly motivated to do so. And yet this argument, even amongst proponents of techno-socialism today, confuse it to be an incentive-based argument, when in fact, the problem is one, the nature of the problem is one of contextual knowledge.
So, Rosolino, just...
Yes?
I think it's important to explain why and how are people saying that this is an incentive-based argument, just to make things clear. Why is that different, even from the incentive-based argument, the argument that you're making?
Because if the data is already assumed to be given, it is simply a matter of just aggregating that data. That is, if individuals are incentivized to aggregate the data, if we have a computer powerful enough with data that's already a given, then that implies that even outside the context of private property, it may indeed be theoretically possible to engage in the calculation argument. But given the very nature of data is emergent, what we take to be as data from the past, having been emergent, may be necessary, but it is not sufficient for predicting human behavior. It may be necessary, just like prices are necessary to guide us in our consumption as well as our production, but it's not a sufficient condition. If prices are a sufficient condition, then that implies that all the knowledge that is necessary in order to engage in the calculation argument is simply a matter of individuals responding to prices set by central planners or set by a computer. Now, some people can be a price taker some of the time, right? You go to a store and you take those prices. But if everyone is a price taker, where do prices come from? Now, again, one thing I want to iterate is that, like the argument that I'm providing here, Mises' argument was not a positive critique, or excuse me, a normative critique of the ends of socialism. Rather, it was simply a positive critique of the coherence between the means and the ends of socialism. And I think this is one of the most important aspects of the intellectual debate that is lost today. Because the debate today has devolved, it has collapsed into one in which opposing camps are being judged on the ends. You think that capitalism is better than socialism because you think socialism is immoral. Or socialists will come back and say, well, capitalism is immoral because of its ends that it's pursuing. That's inconsistent with socialism. No. Both then and now, the debate is one about the means to achieve a particular end. Now,
just to emphasize this, what you are saying is that actually this debate and the conversation and the economic calculation debate, it's in a sense a footnote on a larger approach to social sciences, moral philosophy, ethics, which is emphasizing the difference between means and ends, and it's clarifying the ways we should be approaching in public discourse, institutional design, and so on and so forth, the difference between an approach which is mindlessly focused on ends, right, from an approach which is looking at the ways the relationship between means and ends is structured in various circumstances of life.
Correct.
That's might be the economy, might be, I don't know, social relationships, might be international affairs. We have basically the same pattern. Just wanted to point out that because I think that this is one of the most important
and missed out things in modern political philosophy, moral theory, and so on and so forth. And it's not an accident that this debate is like the footnote of the neoclassical revolution, which emphasized strongly this aspect of the.
And one thing I will add to that, based on what you're saying, one of the things that's not only is Mises's argument among social scientists today still confused as one of purely in terms of incentives, but it's also misunderstood that Mises was not defending a particular social class, for example, capitalists as a particular class. Indeed, what he was doing is, from the standpoint of the market, Marxists, who argued that we need to abolish private property in order to eliminate the wastes of capitalism based on production for exchange, and instead substituting it for direct use. It was Mises who was confronting that very argument, because the basis for a market economy, one in which entrepreneurs are residual claimants, it's far more important that entrepreneurs bear the losses of their decision making, not the consequences, because it's losses or error detection that's manifested in losses amongst entrepreneurs is the correction mechanism by which we eliminate those wastes. So Mises was arguing, yes, I agree, we should eliminate the wastes of capitalism. But the only way to do that is if we have a market economy in the first place. Just as a short footnote, I pursuing my MA at Fordham University, which was a Catholic university, remember I had a Roman Catholic priest named Father Dowling. And one of the things that he taught us, he said, capitalism without losses is like Christianity without hell. It's pure bliss. Mm-hmm. In order to emphasize that the most important thing about the error correction mechanism of a market economy is precisely it exists because we are error prone individuals. I'm going to return to that point in a moment. But encountering Mises' argument, Lange established his argument for market socialism. What he was arguing is that purely on the basis of logic, the outcomes of a market based on a market outcome understood in terms of general competitive equilibrium. By logical deduction, those conditions, since they are institutionally independent, they should just as well hold under socialism. One of the great ironies of the calculation debate is that Mises, a defender of the universal applicability of the laws of economic science, was criticized by Lange as a German historicist, the very school upon which Mises and earlier Austrians were carving out an intellectual tradition, precisely because he was arguing for the institutional necessity of the precondition of properties, precisely because he was saying that property rights are a necessary precondition, that he was labeled as an historicist. Moreover, with both Lange and Lerner actually, by an ironic twist, being one of Hayek's students at the London School of Economics, had argued that any discussion of incentives is not a discussion of economics. It's a discussion of psychology and sociology. And it's for this reason, in confronting this calculation argument, Hayek focused primarily on the knowledge problem. Now, Lange and Lerner had argued we should just simply instruct the managers of state-owned firms to follow the rules of profit maximization that we know from perfect competition, to price at marginal cost and produce at a level that minimizes average cost. If firms do that in the market, they just as well can do that if managers of state-owned firms are going to be instructed to do so. Again, assuming that they have the incentives to do so. Right? But again, that presumes, and what Hayek argued, is that they were assuming away the very problem that they had to address. Namely, that the conditions of profit maximization that we know in perfect competition, pricing according to marginal cost, producing at a level that minimizes average cost, those are outcomes of the market process. They're a byproduct of competition in the market process based on private property. So like King and Petty, they were confronting an argument based on the outcome of the market without an understanding of how the process itself is necessary to generate the very knowledge required to allocate resources to their most valued uses. So market socialism, like techno-socialism, assumes away the very problem it claims to solve. Namely, how the information that we know as data becomes embodied in prices in the first place. For the sake of time, I won't read this entire quote, but the thing I want to stress here is the questions that they raise about the difficulty of techno-socialism goes to the heart of the contextual nature of knowledge that I'm talking about. They ask, how do we measure productivity when the inputs are, say, medical treatment that extends the working life of a person? Is it the value of a longer career? How do we separate the medical treatment that enables a longer working life from other changing variables such as work, relationships, our environment, or not abusing alcohol? This is difficult to do, and questions like these have led researchers to consider what role social factors and cultural context may play in improving productivity and so forth. So here, they are actually invoking the contextual nature of the knowledge problem in allocating scarce capital goods, the means of production, to their most valued uses. Now, this gets to the heart of what distinguishes the Austrian case for the market process in juxtaposition of the neoclassical mainstream. And the reason why I'm invoking this is because one of the great ironies in the history of economic thought, in the calculation argument, is that the very tools that were meant to defend the market economy became the tools to defend central planning. It's as if I were holding a rifle to Professor Aligica, and he turns around that rifle and aims it at me. I'm like, what just happened? So Hayek and Mises had to rediscover or re-articulate their own understanding of the market process. And we today need to re-articulate and understand our understanding of the market process. But then our understanding, yes?
So let me see if I understood what you are saying. So what you are saying is that after we have the developments in neoclassical economics, we have actually a branching, a ramification of the neoclassical tradition. It is the mainstream neoclassical tradition, which is dominating currently the way we are seeing the market. But that specific tradition is missing something extremely important, which is making actually the tradition to be used now, technically, in such kind of arguments against the market.
Correct.
And what you are claiming is that actually you want to recover the other branching of that tradition, which is given by Mises and Hayek, which is the one that is still capturing the key argument, which is allowing us to understand current developments like techno-socialism. Without that, and using just standard mainstream neoclassical textbook economics, we only able to capture what is significant and important in that argument.
Exactly.
It's like having a theoretical lenses. One has the theoretical lenses to allow you to discern something, the other one doesn't have it.
Right.
Is it correct?
That's exactly right. In fact, I'll even invoke a quote from an historian of economic thought at the London School of Economics. Her name is Mary Morgan. It's a great book called The World in a Model. And she has this beautiful line where she says, narratives about markets are built into the models from the very start. What Professor Aligica is trying to get us to think about is that the model of equilibrium can only take us in a binary direction. It can either illustrate that markets are always and everywhere efficient, or they are hopelessly inefficient, in need of a deus ex machina, a central planner for correction. What I'm suggesting is that the Austrian paradigm transcends those two. Not by saying that markets are perfect, but in fact, because they are imperfect, but not in the sense of being flawed or suboptimal or non-ideal compared to perfect competition by which Lange and Lerner were assessing the efficiency of real world markets. They were arguing that markets are prone to failure, in need of correction. What I am suggesting is, if we look at the meaning of the word and trace the etymology of the Latin verb imperfect back to its roots, im is the negation, not. Per comes from the Latin adverb, thoroughly, or thoroughly done. And fect comes from the Latin verb facere, to do. So to say a market is imperfect is simply to say it's incomplete. So our markets are imperfect? Of course they are. That's the point. They are an error correction mechanism. They're not flawed because human beings are imperfect. We need them precisely because they're imperfect. And more importantly, as I had said, the nature of this knowledge is contextual. So the great Austrian economist, Don Lavoy, makes the analogy of the knowledge that's embodied in prices analogous to riding a bicycle. That is knowledge that's inarticulate or tacit. So knowledge that is required in order to allocate resources to their most valued uses, that's embodied in prices, can't be quantified or can't be generated and therefore not generated from a computer. What I am suggesting is that the nature of the knowledge is more akin to a bicycle kick in football or soccer. A bicycle kick only makes sense as a strategy. It emerges only in the context of the rules of soccer or football. Have you ever seen a bicycle kick outside of the game?
For a football spot.
Oh, thank you very much. No. In fact, it would look ridiculous. The only reason you know the meaning of that activity, that strategy, is because you know what the rules of soccer are in the first place. So what does that imply about central planning? Or even techno-socialism? What it means to cost minimize or to profit maximize? Those strategies only exist in the context of private property. What it means to profit maximize, what it means to cost minimize is just as the nature of that is contextual, in the same way that engaging in a bicycle kick only emerges in the rules of soccer. Now, this also reveals an important distinction I want to draw upon: information or knowledge about preferences. The nature of preferences, and Mises argues this, if we were to assume that all of individual preferences were static, then the nature of the calculation problem would go away and techno-socialism would be a viable means to achieve that end. But the nature of the market process is one in which we have two sets of variables. We have underlying variables, preferences, technology, and available resources. And then we have an induced set of variables, prices, quantities, and methods of production. In equilibrium, the underlying variables collapse onto the induced variables. So prices reflect full and available information about least cost technologies and preferences. But in a world of changing preferences, where preferences cannot be directly reducible and are not defined independently of individuals, precisely because preferences emerge in the context of choice, where your choices are made and respond depending on what other people's choices make, such information doesn't exist that is directly reducible to individuals. It's knowledge that is emergent. And the quotes that I'm drawing from here comes from a more recent article. Two advocates of what I'm referring to as techno-socialism, Paul Cockshott and Philip Dappert, Cockshott being a computer scientist. And they argue, first, we need information on the conditions of production. Right? What production technologies are available? What resources can be used? Secondly, we need information on what products are needed on consumer demand. What's the solution? Equilibrium prices of products are compared to labor values, which can be derived from disaggregate input-output tables. But again, prices are necessary, but they are not sufficient for the calculation problem. In other words, equilibrium prices assume the very knowledge to be existent that can only be generated in the context of the exchange of property rights. This point that I'm trying to get at is captured perfectly by a piece written by the Nobel laureate, James Buchanan, who is not a participant of the calculation debate, but is very relevant for the point that I'm making here. And I just want to read from the italicized quote. They say, he's talking here about individuals, the model of market socialism, which is based upon individuals maximizing their utility. As if they know, as if they have perfect knowledge about what is the choice beforehand, before they make a choice, that which will maximize their utility. But what Buchanan is arguing here, he is saying the potential participants in a market do not know until they enter the process what their choices will be. So how can we feed data into a computer presuming that individuals don't know the choices they're going to make until they make the choice? If the data can be fed into the computer, that precludes the true and genuine nature of choice, which is decision-making under uncertainty. So it assumes away the very problem of choice itself. And again, just to reiterate this point, emphasized by the Austrian economist, von Lavoie, the nature of the knowledge that he's talking about in the market process assumes knowledge that no individual, no rival, that is, rivaling entrepreneurs, would be able to possess in absence of that rivalry. In the same way that you won't know the score of a soccer game before the game is finished. And as emphasized by Pete Becky, the contextual nature of that knowledge is one in which, outside of the context, this knowledge doesn't exist. In the time that I have left, I've been talking very theoretically. I'm just going to give a very concrete and simple example to summarize everything that I've said thus far. And this example is going to be drawn not from someone we traditionally identify with the Austrian school, nor a participant of the calculation debate. I don't know how many know this figure, Julian Simon. He wrote this fantastic book in 1981 called The Ultimate Resource, the ultimate resource being the human mind. What he is less known for today is he wrote an article in 1968 called An Almost Practical Solution to Airline Overbooking. Anybody ever been on an overbooked flight? He's the one that pioneered this idea. He was basically laughed and criticized by airlines for 10 years over this idea. Now, his point was very, very simple, is that airlines overbook flights because individuals may at the last minute cancel their flights. It's a profit maximizing strategy, but one in which airlines do imperfectly. In effect, you could think of your airline ticket is a property right over a means of production. It's a capital good that allows you to travel from point A to point B. So what did Simon argue? He said, let's just implement a reverse auction. Rather than bumping individuals involuntarily from a flight through coercion, let's just implement, in effect, let's create property rights. Paul and I we have conflicting aims over this seat. The airline tickets have been oversold. We both, because of our tickets, have a property right over a particular seat. The question is, who is the individual on the flight that is the least or the most willing to get off the flight, reflected in the lowest price. Do the airlines know that? No. Do any of you know if you are going to be that person outside that context? No. Nobody knows. How does it become discovered? Is it a matter of computing the data? As if we would know beforehand, we could just read anybody's minds and know who is the individual who will take the lowest price to move to a lower flight? No, he said, let's just implement an auction. He's articulating the calculation argument. He's saying, let's allow property rights over the seats to be exchanged. And through the exchange process, we will discover the individual who is the most willing to be moved to a lower flight, to another flight, reflected in the lowest price. Here's the point I want to make.
So this is the point where they say we are overbooked, but we are offering $500 to somebody who...
Exactly.
If nobody's showing up, then say, okay, we are offering $800.
Exactly. So and the price...
Yet price is going until you find somebody who is ready to leave the flight for the next one.
Now, here's the key point that I'm making here. Note that the calculation argument was opposed, right? Mises' argument was made in the context of centralized planning of an entire economy by an individual that is operating outside the market. This is a for-profit industry. They are trying to engage in a profit-maximizing strategy, and we're only talking about 400 seats. And without a market, they are not able to allocate those resources efficiently, the seats efficiently. So now I ask you, if we put so much hope into artificial intelligence to solve the calculation problem, and a computer can't even allocate 400 seats without a market, how the hell can we expect, pardon my language, for computers to engage in efficient allocation of resources? Because even in this context, markets are necessary to discover that contextual knowledge, the knowledge that only emerges in that particular time and place. Because those prices, even though there were previous prices used in previous auctions, they're not applicable at that context of time and place, given the preferences of the individuals on that flight. That knowledge is irrelevant in the same way that data that is used. Now, don't get me wrong, artificial intelligence is a very important tool for the computation of data. It can aggregate past information, but it cannot predict future behavior. Markets are necessary to generate that contextual knowledge. I'm sorry I'm over time, but just to conclude very briefly, again, as Mises and Hayek argued, I am restating their arguments to state that techno-socialism, like market socialism, is impossible. And that the solution to the informational problem that the techno-socialists claim to be solving is one of a computation of data, not the discovery of contextual knowledge. Thank you for your attention.
As promised, now we are moving to the conversational, or more conversational segment of our evening. And obviously, as I have mentioned, I'm going to be the facilitator, and I'm going to somehow try to make the transition from the presentation to the conversation by asking the first question. Also asking you whether we could turn this off. I don't think that I'm needing it anymore. So, Rosolino, just to provide the transition to the conversation, but also to set up the stage for what I think would be an interesting and productive way of engaging in the conversation. Because there is a danger here, and the danger is this, that lo and behold, we have managed again to make the argument against the silliness of socialists who are not understanding the calculation debate. And this is an excellent point, but we remember what happened last time in history as a result of this debate. And I think that if that is the case, I think that your presentation and its implications are very sobering and not very optimistic for us. In what sense? Something has happened, nonetheless, in terms of economic systems, institutional designs, industry. Whatever that thing, definitely the thing wasn't able to solve the economic calculation problem. But yet the system was set in place, and we know what happened for almost 100 years in the places where the system was set in place under the powers, right? So we know that. And the question is, what is going to happen now? Assuming that Rosolino's argument is correct, and these guys were unable to solve the economic calculation debate, so they will be unable to create a techno-socialist as they were unable to create the real socialism that they wanted, what the heck is going on? What are these guys doing? What kind of system are they implementing? What are the ways in which we should be engaging with that system in order to get a better sense of how we could either stop it or maybe encouraging it if we realize that it is something, we don't know what, but it is something that might be viable. But definitely, whatever it is, it's not going to solve the problems that Rosolino has mentioned, as the previous round of socialists was unable to solve those problems. So this is one challenge. What is going on? What do these people want? Because we have seen already this happening in history, when people are signaling out that they want to solve an efficiency problem or a resource allocation problem, and they pretend that they have the means to do it, they are unable to do it in practice, and yet they are doing stuff in practice. So this is my first point, and then I'm not going to abuse my position, but I'm going to pick up on what you have said, which is very important, because I think that this is the key to what is happening. You mentioned that there is something very important in the conversation, which is preferences, right? Preferences are crucial. So this system, even if it is pretending that it is using the economic calculation debate as a vehicle and dissolving it, it's actually a system which is targeting preferences. And the techno-structure which is used is a techno-structure which is assuming that it would be able to explain, predict, and control preferences. So once you have stabilized preferences, now you are able to increase control, right? You have mentioned technology, the resources, and human preferences. Now, you know the discourse about resources and natural resources and so on and so forth. They are finite, right? Not like Julian Simon has mentioned, they are actually something that are finite, controllable, right? And which should be managed in a very tight way, right? Now, we see that preferences actually might be managed, might be targeted, might be controlled, and very important in the context of Rosolino's presentation, he connected preferences with what? With choices. The less degrees of freedom you have to make choices, right, the more your preferences are kept under control. The more your preferences are kept under control, the better they are able to plan and organize things on the parameters that they mentioned, assuming that, right, they are able to control the other two factors, which is technology and resources. So I think that this is one of the clues by which we should be approaching our understanding of this system. So economic calculation is a starting point, understanding what is feasible and what is not feasible based on that is an excellent way to go into the conversation, but we want to know more. We want to understand more what is going on in fact when these kind of systems are tentatively implemented. So that being said, I think that I have provided enough of a transition from the presentation to the conversation. So let's open up for a question or comments Yes.
Should I respond directly?
Yes, please.
Okay. So, Paul, you put many different strands of questions on the table. Let me respond first in terms of the following. So, right before coming here, as a matter of fact, I think that it's in many ways a, maybe a happy coincidence. I was asked to participate in a colloquium that is organized by an organization in the United States called Liberty Fund. And they had, the colloquium was specifically on the nature, on the relationship between human agency and artificial intelligence. Now, I was there with, I was the sole economist in the room. It was a group of philosophers and computer scientists. Why do I mention all of this? I say this because of two things. One, if indeed, as you have suggested, that in order for the system to work, it would imply the control of preferences, then that gives away the entire argument. It assumes away the very problem that the techno-socialist, go ahead.
Sorry to interrupt you. So yeah. I didn't mean that just by satisfying the preference control condition, you'll be able to solve the problem.
Yeah.
What I meant that the preference control condition is important in order to understand what is going to happen in real life techno-socialism.
Right.
Because as you remember, we had theoretical socialism and then we had the real life socialism. In a similar way, we have techno-socialism, which is pretending to solve the economic calculation problem, but then we have the real life techno-socialism. And real life techno-socialism, that was my argument, won't be able to get the full control, but will make a very aggressive step forward in controlling preferences in order to increase the sphere of its operation. So that was my point. So I'm not making the mistake of not understanding your basic argument.
No, I did get, but you cut me off before I was going to finish. So okay, I was going to pick up where you were going to.
No, it's fine. I used to be misquoted, so that's why now I have a sort of reflex on that.
So. No, so the point I want to make is the following, and based on the question that Professor Aligică has put forward. Suppose, for example, that we implement a system of techno-socialism, which is predicated on the idea that it can utilize computer technology to satisfy consumer preferences, but then it cannot. So it doesn't have the contextual economic knowledge available to it. Then how does the system survive? If it's in the hand of political officials, it can only utilize the knowledge that it's available to it, which is political knowledge. Political knowledge, which is based on the preferences of those individuals that are in control to implement the ends that they preconceive are those appropriate for society. Now, on another strand of argument, based on the colloquium that I just attended, many of the reactions to AI and artificial intelligence are arguments in fear of the rise of a sentient being and therefore the replacement of human employment by self-generated robots and so on and so forth. So amongst the computer scientists I had met, we are not even at the stage in which individuals like King and Petty are hypothesizing we are even at. So we're not even at the doorstep of that. That being said, to answer your question, the worst thing that we can do is to make the same conflation that the advocates of techno-socialism, that is, if they are conflating the discovery of contextual knowledge with computational data, we in turn should not throw out the baby with the bathwater. We need to understand that that computer technology is a very important and viable tool for computation of data. And therefore it is very limited. But to the extent that we double down and then react in such a way, overreact to the rise of computer technology for fear of its use in the political sphere, it may generate that very outcome. That's one fear that I have. I think if that addresses your question.
Just 1 second, because I think that this is crucial for the way the conversation is set up, and I want to lay this on on the table, because again, it is crucial. So there are two schools of thought on this. The mainstream school of thought, which is including even many people who are concerned about these developments, and has you have seen the position voiced by Rosolino, is basically an information revolution, information technology reading of the developments in the last 60, 50 years or so. The accent is on information, the accent is on knowledge processes, if you are more sophisticated as we are, so we are not just living in a world of data and information, but we are moving to knowledge processes and so on, and we are making this kind of line of argument. However, I think that that line of argument is missing something extremely important. Before being the information revolution, before being the world of Shannon and the theory of information, which was happening at the end of the 50s, at the beginning of the 60s, this world that has been created and we are now populating was the world of cybernetics. And that was a cybernetic revolution. Now, you know what cybernetics means? Where is that coming, the word from? It's coming from Greek. And it's a theory, right? Cyber was the guy who was steering the ship, the governor of the ship. So this is a theory of control. So cybernetics was developed as a theory of control by analyzing the feedback loops in systems. In order to organize a feedback loop, you need information. This is the place of information. This is where everything has started, with the place of information, in order to be able to steer the ship, to control things, to navigate things. In order to be the controller, you needed information. So that was a cybernetic revolution, emphasizing information for means of control, right? So we should keep in mind that each time we are saying the society of information, information society, right? We are living a revolution of information. We are also living a revolution of control. So this is a society of control. The society of cybernetics is a society of control. So therefore, when the mainstream school of thought is putting an emphasis on information or knowledge, as in our conversation, is taking us in a very interesting and important direction. And this is thoroughly, that this direction has been thoroughly mapped up by Rosolino. When, on the other hand, in this conversation, I'm emphasizing the issue of preferences and preference control and preference manipulation and reducing the space of choice in order to stabilize the space of decision and the space of control, right? I'm emphasizing the cybernetic dimension of this revolution. So I just wanted to point out those two things, because I think that they should go together. We should analyze things together. I think that none of these two sides should operate without the other one. But at this point, I think that there is too much emphasis on the information aspects of things, right? Which was actually the thing that misled us for 30 or 40 years, right? As opposed to the control side of things. Sorry.
Let me follow up with that on this point. I said a lot about the difference between prices being a necessary, though not sufficient, condition. And let me expand on that idea for a moment. I don't know how many of you here are familiar with the investors Charlie Munger and Warren Buffett, okay, who are, you know, multi-billionaires in the US. But the way they got very, very wealthy was actually on a very, very simple idea, which is in 1988, they made a huge investment in Coca-Cola Company. Now, at the time in which they did it, by every quantifiable measure, that stock was considered to be expensive. So they saw a profit opportunity that was not yet embedded or fully reflected in the price. Had the prices been in sufficient condition, then there was no profit opportunity to be gathered. A computer could, in effect, set the prices and exhaust all profit opportunities. Now, the way in which they went about their investment was not of a quantitative nature, it was a very qualitative. They just asked very basic questions. How many ounces of water does an individual drink? I think it's about 64. And how many of those ounces are in soft drinks? And how many of those ounces of soft drinks are Coca-Cola? And then they imagine the pot. Notice that they use their tacit and inarticulate knowledge. But it wasn't fully embedded in the prices. it got reflected in the prices, it got communicated. They drove up the stock 12-fold, well, not they, but the stock was driven up 12-fold thereafter, because then this information became embedded in the prices. But before then, it was simply subjective in their minds. So with the nature of the price mechanism, what it does is that it translates, like a telecommunication mechanism, subjectively held knowledge into publicly available information. Subjectively held knowledge that emerges in a context into publicly available information. So that prices are indeed necessary, but if prices reflected the subjective knowledge of time and place, no choice would be needed by individuals.
So probably another way to put the last point you made also is to say past prices
or sure.
realized prices.
Right.
I have three comments. Let's say maybe there's some question behind it, but I'll say them and you just let me know your thoughts
sure.
on them. First, I think Mises had this good idea at the time of conceding the free market for goods, for consumption goods. And analytically, it's a good idea. But in this context, in which Professor Aligică also highlights the management of preferences, maybe it's not such a good idea, because you cannot actually sever the formation of preferences in the market and the consumption good from the production sphere, because in this world, we form preferences for consumption only informing ourselves with the prices even on factors of production. So it's a constant feedback. So I don't even know what I will prefer tomorrow independently of the structure of production. So it's strategically a good idea, but now we should maybe emphasize the reintegration of these two aspects. So it's not so easy to just concede preferences as fixed. I know Professor Salerno has this example of houses built not in New York or not in, but built somewhere in some distant agrarian state, because the cost of production to build houses there and ship them into urban areas is lower and makes us do that thing which would be inconceivable just from the point of view of consumer preferences severed from the context of production. The second point, even if we concede that there are no preferences, Mises always pushed this idea. But what about this huge structure of production in which you would have to have exchanges by entrepreneurs, bidding, judging, appraising, as he uses a specific words. And those are not consumption goods. So they are not doing the imputation of their personal preferences on those goods. So they have to emerge genuine market prices for factors of production for which the entrepreneurs do not have personal preference. Or they also have them in their capacity as consumers, but that's not the point. They don't want them for their personal consumption. So maybe this would be a defense. The techno-socialism would still be incoherent. And the third point I want to make, I agree with Professor Aligică that they will try to make a mockery, but playing it serious, of the economy as being much more coordinated. If we manage the preferences with ESG, scores, diversity, inclusion, and they will say, now we solve the issue. And probably, if the population is weak in terms of, let's say, personal character, virtue, and stuff, so if you have a vicious population, it will more easily go along with such a plan. Maybe they will even be more easily manageable, because a man who has a vice is pretty predictable. So if you need to drink, you will drink. So the preferences are not such a mystery, and they're quite stable. Forgive me for a long intervention. Please let me know your thoughts.
You make a very important point that I had made implicit, but I'm glad that you made it explicit. So when I said a free market in consumer goods, what I meant was free market in final output. Final output sold to consumers. That being said, you are 100% right. And this, I think, is still misunderstood, not only amongst individuals who might be advocates of techno-socialism, but even defenders of a market economy today.
Even Mises might have underestimated the consequences of his admission.
Okay. What I wanted to stress is one thing that you are honing in on, it's very important, is that entrepreneurs are consumers of inputs. What that implies is the supply curve we usually think of, or prior to the marginal revolution, it was conceived of that being objective, therefore given. But in fact, what we call the supply curve is actually the demand curve for suppliers of inputs. So it's also subjective. But more importantly, on the imputation point that you're making, even if we are conceding a free market, that there is exchange in final output, you and I are old enough, maybe other people in the audience, are to remember when phone calls were made with a telephone cord. A price mechanism is like a telephone cord connecting a consumer to the producer. And if railroads are built with platinum, and the entrepreneur sustains losses, why do they sustain losses? It's because the consumer is saying, platinum is too expensive. It has to be allocated to more valued uses. Now, the prices are not a set of marching orders that communicate this knowledge directly. All that the entrepreneur needs to know is that the price of platinum is too high. But even assuming a free market in consumer goods and the means of production are socialized, that's analogous to cutting the cord in the middle of a call. So you could be as loud as you can with your free market in consumer goods, but if the cord is severed, the message will never arrive to the entrepreneur. It's in this sense that Hayek referred to prices as this telecommunication mechanism.
To jump in on your metaphor, there are also calls between entrepreneurs.
Yes. Yep.
Okay, just to give you a heads up where we are, so let's say 25 minutes more of a formal conversation, and then we stop the formal conversation and we continue informally with those that would like to continue informally in the conversation, but we don't want to create a sort of captive audience here for a never-ending back and forth. So that being said, let's see if there are other questions or comments, and let me just feel the silence. One of the concerns that we have in this respect, at least that I have in this respect of this conversation, is actually taking this debate on techno-socialism in a direction and using the means of the 20th century without fully taking into the consideration the radical changes of the structural nature of the new system which is emerging. And I'm going to give you two examples, because I think that they are crucial for the exchange here. So obviously the relationship between the means of production and the market of the production goods, and the structure of production until the consumer, this is extremely important in this context. However, I think that this should be calibrated with two aspects that are crucial and are happening on our own house. So the first is what we have called the surveillance capitalism. So the surveillance capitalism is a game changer. It's a structural change. It's not just a sort of footnote on the pre-existing structures of capitalism on the market. So this thing is a game changer we have to take into account, especially in terms of monitoring, controlling, manipulating preferences and subjective views of people. Second, money. So in the entire discussion was presumed a certain form of monetary system. And usually we are presuming certain forms of monetary system. Sometimes we're presuming a sort of gold standard or monetary system. Sometimes we are presuming a sort of benign form of fiat money.
But think of what it means in terms of digital currencies introduced in a system in which we have no idea where the surveillance capitalism is ending and where the political process that Rosolino appealed to a little bit earlier is starting. So that new system is something unseen, unheard of. We can't even understand the contours of what is raising ahead of us. And I think that we should be always prepared to calibrate and reinvent everything that we have learned in the last 200 years or so since Adam Smith to confront what is ahead of us. Is this an institutional change structure? Yes, indeed, it's an institutional, formidable institutional structure. But as Rosolino has mentioned, we can't think of these processes in an institutionally accepted world. And the context of this conversation and the context of what is happening around has to take into account these two things. The developments in the monetary system, which is basically changing the way we are thinking, even about a supply and demand of money, right? And every implications as a result of that. And second, this new techno structure of surveillance, of big data, and of organized forms of using them both in the virtual space and in a non-virtual space, in real life. Because as you know, this thing is happening not only when we are traveling in the virtual world, but also when we are traveling to market, to the physical market, to the market over there. It's tracing everything that we are doing, where are we going, and what we are buying, right? And I think that we have to take into account that. Yes, please.
I'm not sure what do you mean by calibrate and adapt, because Adam Smith and maybe, I don't know, Bastiat and everyone before and after, because the ideas were not new. He was describing reality. What we are seeing now is a perversion of reality. Okay, all this surveillance, the phone that you used, the way that you showed us, it's a perversion of reality. So how should we adapt to that or fight it? Because in my view, we're at a point where people are just not going to war because they're hoping somehow that things are going to return to that reality. That someone is going to say, okay, we were wrong about this and we perverted our reality, we should go back. But I think if we adapt, we just let a nihilistic part of society dictate the terms and change reality on us, and in the end, we're going to end up losing if we keep just being reactive to what it's been for the better part of the last 200 years, an active aggression against liberty, against reality itself, against common sense, and against everything else. And I'd like to, hear what you both have to say, at least if that's not too much to ask.
So, there are two different, I think there are two distinct issues that we have at play here. One is the nature of the way in which firms in a market economy gather information and the way in which they use it. Okay. Then there's another issue, and that's the issue which, it's distinct and may not be where you're getting at, but it is related. But it's a big issue that has begun, at least in the United States, but I think it's now going to very quickly extend, if it has not, to the European Union, which is the notion that big tech companies, with their ability to surveil consumers and the monopolistic and concentrated nature of this industry, is ripe, you might say, not only for surveillance, but also political capture. That is a distinct issue. What I would argue is, in many ways, although these are new manifestations, they are a difference of degree rather than of kind. What do I mean by that? The argument, the argument against firms, quote-unquote, surveilling their consumers is the same argument that was made by John Kenneth Galbraith in his book, The Affluent Society, in which he argued about this dependence effect. That, for example, now that we live in an affluent society and the basic needs of hunger and in the developed world have been satisfied, then what firms are doing are manipulating the preferences of individuals. If that is true, if firms are manipulating the preference of individuals, and this was Hayek's response, he said this argument is a non sequitur. Because if it's the case that firms already know the preferences and can and know how to manipulate the preferences of individuals, why do they advertise? Advertising implies that they are, you might say, discovering knowledge about the preferences of individuals. So that's the first issue. My point is not to dismiss the problem. What I'm saying is that it's a restatement or rearticulation of an older fear, which is the role in which firms play in forming the preferences of individuals. But Hayek's point is that that argument assumes as if individuals' preferences are made in an acontextual manner, when in fact my preference for a tie, although it's generated by what firms are selling me, but it's also generated by the social norms that are created in society. So the issue is much more complex than it might otherwise seem. So that's the first answer. But I think the greater threat is, again, the fear of concentration in platform economies today, the way in which they're able to aggregate their data, and the fear, because the industry is so concentrated, it's more prone to political influence, which then surveillance capitalism can then turn into real surveillance. With that argument, you might say, neglects is the following. Is that I believe that argument puts the cart before the horse. Because it puts the cart before the horse, the thing that we mistake as the potential for surveillance capitalism is actually a consequence of undermining the conditions of our market. What do I mean? For example, Jeff Bezos, in forming Amazon, did not have all the capital that was necessary for him to establish Amazon. Nor did Jack Ma with Alibaba. Yet today it's argued because these firms are so large and can realize economies of scale, it's a barrier to entry to outside firms. And therefore, that eliminates a check on their potential monopoly power. But how did Amazon get big in the first place? It's a mechanism that we neglect that's a part of a market economy, which is limited liability. What does limited liability do? It reduces the transaction costs of allowing investors to buy and sell shares in a firm because their liability is only limited to the investments they make in the firm rather than their own personal wealth. It's an endogenous mechanism by which firms are able to raise capital. But that capital is based upon an entrepreneur having a good idea and insight. So the proponents of antitrust regulation today, in which they claim that capital ownership is a barrier to entry, as I said, are putting the cart before the horse, because capital ownership is a consequence of entrepreneurship, not a prerequisite of being an entrepreneur. Your ability to raise capital is a byproduct of having a good entrepreneurial insight that attracts investors. But the argument that is in the way in which it's usually set up assumes that the prerequisite, and this is where the neoclassical mainstream and the Austrian paradigm are truly distinct on the nature of competition, the role of regulating monopolies or antitrust policy as it's called in the US. So my fear is not the existence of entrepreneurs coming into the market and realizing economies of scale. What I am worried about is that if economists are proffering policy advice based on a fundamentally basic but mistaken understanding of the nature of capital and entrepreneurship, that capital is not a prerequisite to entrepreneurship, can generate misleading and dangerous policy recommendations for antitrust regulation, which is ripe, because what happens? Instead of having the invisible hand of the market, there's the invisible hand of government that intervenes, and then the firms can capture.
Very visible.
It's very visible. To capture the regulation, and then the data that they've gathered about consumers can be then captured by the government. That's what I'm ultimately worried about. But again, these things turn on just subtleties, I believe, at least amongst economists in economic theory. I hope I addressed your question.
Thank you. Yeah.
Questions?
No. Okay. So just to bring it back to sort of the main topic of this evening, and I know you've addressed it before, but let's see. I was wondering if we can have a more simpler pitch, right? So socialism has always been looking for the next magical thing to make it work.
Yes.
It was usually, okay, if we just have enough computing power, it's going to work. Now people finally realize that not even quantum computing is going to help with the calculation problem, so they say, okay, maybe AI will help,
yeah.
Right? So my first question is, how do we make the layperson on the street understand, no, it won't? That's one. And the second one, which comes on top of it, is when the layperson on the street also hears about nudging techniques, putting that on top of AI, how do we explain that's not going to help either?
Okay. So there are, let me put two ish, I'll address that in a twofold manner. Let me address the first point that you make. The easiest way to put that, I think, is to argue that AI cannot interpret a context. So an example that I give to illustrate this, is in 1983, I'm sure many people here are familiar with Stanislav Petrov, the Russian colonel, who in effect, based upon the recommendations of computers, there was a false warning of a nuclear strike coming from the United States. And all the recommendations according to the computers were to say for Colonel Petrov to fire back. Had it been operated by AI, I don't know if anyone has seen the American movie War Games. It's actually quite similar to what happened. And in the movie and both Petrov, what did they do? They said, wait a minute. If the US is going to strike the Soviet Union, they're not going to do it with five warheads. They're going to do it with thousands at a time if they're going to win this war. So he stopped, he waited, and he saw, given the context, given the way he interpreted the knowledge available to him, that this must be a mistake. The computer, although it's quantifying the available information, it's not taking into the context that if there was going to be a thermonuclear war, it would be an all-out policy, not one based on a few missiles. The other issue with regards to nudging and so on and so forth, here's the way I would respond to that. One from a theoretical level, and one from a practical level. On the theoretical level, the nudge argument presumes that the policymakers know the preferences of the individuals before they even made their own choices. And the reason why that's important, especially amongst economists, not the everyday man and woman, is that the basis for nudging, which is the field of behavioral economics, which claims to be a critique, a rejection of the tools of utility maximization that neoclassical economics is based upon, in fact, is a reinsertion of that very model for making policy recommendations. So in many ways, the way I put this to my students is that behavioral economics is the spoiled stepchild of neoclassical economics. You know, imagine a spoiled child. Oh, I hate you, Dad. I hate you, Dad. But I need money, right? So they reject the tools for the analysis as a model, but then reinsert the model in order to advocate policy recommendations. Now, at a more practical level, here is where I'm what I'm more worried about is the utilization of nudging and techniques and the implementation of syntaxes in order to drive out competition in the market. Now, here's an interesting fact. This is in the United States. Up until the 1960s, the profit margin of cigarette companies was very, very low. You would think that after there were regulations on advertising and the production of cigarettes, that their profitability would go down. In fact, the industry has become concentrated and profits have significantly increased in the United States. I wonder who lobbied for that regulation. So again, my point is, for every regulation, we have to keep in mind that there are always two interest groups. And I'm borrowing a term from a public choice economist named Bruce Yandel. That is, there are Baptists and there are bootleggers. And this terminology comes from the fact that in the United States, where there have been restrictions on the production and the sale of alcohol on Sundays, there have been two interest groups who you think would not be united over a common regulation, but in fact are. You have the Baptists. These are individuals of strong religious convictions that believe that alcohol should not be consumed on the Lord's Day. Now, who is actually also in favor of that? Illegal sellers of alcohol on the black market. Now, why would they be in favor of that? Because if no one's selling alcohol legally on Sunday, that creates a market for them. Hence, behind every regulation, we have to take into account there are always sincere good doers, the Baptists, and then there are the bootleggers. As one more example to illustrate this point. In the United States, it's very, very difficult to buy incandescent light bulbs nowadays. Now, the biggest supporter of that regulation is, lo and behold, it was General Electric in 2006. Now, why would General Electric be in favor of an environmental bill that basically restricted the production of incandescent light bulbs? Who's going to be better and more efficient at producing energy efficient light bulbs? Smaller companies or a large company like General Electric? I wonder why they supported that regulation in the name of the environment. So this is my fear, that any regulation, whether it's for nudging purposes, whether it's improving individuals' preferences for the environment, we always have to be wary of this regulatory capture.
Thanks, Rosolino. I have Robert, but before that, I just want to make a step back and set the conversation in a larger picture, just to make a better sense of where we are. As you can see, there are two ways of looking at the issue of techno-socialism. On the one hand is to look at, let's say, the institutional design proposed by the proponents of techno-socialism, and use arguments like, for instance, the economic calculation argument, as Rosolino did, in order to say that that system is not going to work, or to use a series of arguments based on either microeconomics or institutional economics or industrial organization in order to make arguments against that kind of development, that kind of process, which says this is mostly like business as usual. And in one way or another, we will be seeing reasserting the same forces, the market forces, versus the political forces at work as in the past. This is a theoretical argument. This is an argument about the feasibility and possibility of an institutional design and a series of scenarios built up around the sort of models running in our heads about what is going to happen.
there is a different type of approach, which is similar with the old socialist debate. We are looking at real life socialism. This is the same thing here. We are looking at real life techno-socialism and trying to understand what is going on, what is the structure, in what measure this new entity, this new economic system is different from everything that has been ever before, like in the case of socialism. Real life socialism was something like never have ever seen before the Bolshevik Revolution. The same thing here. So there are two types of arguments, they are going together, but just wanted to make sure that we understand where we are now. These are not footnotes. What Rosolino was saying, or the various points that we are making, are not food, just footnotes. They are the core of this conversation, but this conversation goes on two tracks. Right? Robert.
Thank you. I just want to check if I understood correct your exchange with Professor Aligică. So Professor Aligică said that if we have a situation in which the preferences of people are manipulated, and let's say that we induce some kind of homogeneous preferences to all of those people that are making decisions.
Right.
Even if that is the case, because of the kind of knowledge that is required for making decisions in terms of production and distribution of goods, it's impossible to have socialism.
Correct.
Okay.
Based on the stated end of advanced material production.
Yes. So it seems that your entire argument is based on a conception of what knowledge and information is that is needed for that kind of calculation.
Correct.
So if it is the case, you are not interested in the preferences of individuals, and you can say that they are homogeneous or heterogeneous, you are not interested in them, right?
Well, if they are what you're saying is a very important question. If they are indeed homogenous,
you started, Rosolino, this is what he's teaching about the Hussies, the preference formation and stuff.
No, I wasn't going to go down that rabbit hole.
I just wanted to be preemptive because I've been with him in many seminars and I know what's happening when they're asking the Hussies to be the question of preference formation.
No, what's that? What's at stake if we're making the argument about homogeneous preferences or heterogeneous preferences is a question of whether they can be, what is the nature of aggregation, and first of all, can they be aggregated? And what's the role, what's the function of the price of a mechanism, and what happens when we separate? If we are taking preferences to be homogeneous, that's analogous to imagine having a puzzle and a frame where, in effect, the picture is simply directly reducible to the pieces. So if preferences are homogeneous, then in effect, one individual can be representative of the entire society, right? If you have a preference and it's homogeneous for everyone else, then it's simply a matter of just gathering the information from you, right? But if preferences are heterogeneous, and those preferences are formed, not you as Robert, as an isolated hermit, but in interaction with other individuals, what you want to buy, what you want to sell, why you want to buy it, for what purpose, if those choices are formed in the context of social interaction, then those preferences are not directly reducible to any individual or group of individuals. In other words, the sum of those heterogeneous preferences are greater than its parts. Right?
They are a byproduct of interaction.
Right. But if we were to say they are directly reducible, as if they are pieces of a puzzle, then it's simply just having the proper incentives to aggregating that information, to getting those pieces of the puzzle. But in society, those very pieces emerge in the context of interaction.
I see something on this
yeah.
line.
So this is a very interesting and well taken point. But I want to go back just to emphasize an alternative way of seeing things,
which is not contradicting this point, but is pointing out a different concern than one might have, or a different understanding. Rosolino at one point gave an example of his tie. I don't remember the specifics, but he was using preferences about his tie and the price of his tie as an example. My concern is not of a situation in which, I don't know, the circumstances, social circumstances in which the transactions over ties and the formation of prices and preferences over ties is in case because it is distorted, undermined, and so on. My concern is about a situation, it's a very preference of a tie because it is Western, it is sexist, it is racist, and so on. It's simply erased as a preference. So there are no ties, no traces of the ties. And the very fact that the resources should be used for ties is a non-issue. So this is my concern. But like I said, my concern is not undermining the structural argument made by him, because obviously, Rosolino's point would be that those resources would be moved in the area where the preferences would manifest. And my point then would be again, what are those preferences and how the space of those preferences would be restrained next, right? And again, would be a space of preferences between very, very minor differences between, I don't know, the Chinese suit, which is has three buttons or two buttons or one button larger and one button smaller, so that's those are the space, this is the space of preferences. So obviously you could control much better and predict, right, the choices when you have one blue suit with two types of buttons, right, small or large. So that's my kind of concern. But again, the structural problem remains the same. So that doesn't mean that these two types of approaches are somehow contradicting each other. So both of them are legitimate, and this is from the very beginning, this is what we have said. This is the way we should be approaching things in the convergence of this. So we promise that every good thing in this work has a beginning, a middle, and the end. Now we are towards the end of the conversation from a formal standpoint. So this is what we are going to do. We'll continue the conversation informally. We wrap up now the formal conversation. Then we take a break of about 5 minutes. You could go at the bar and get something. And we'll continue to be here. Rosolino will continue to be here and answer questions and provide challenging topics. I know that he has a lot of many other things to say on all the issues on the table. I'd like to thank Rosolino for the excellent presentation and the opportunity he gave us to have this conversation. I'd like to thank again Tudor and Mrs. Institute for organizing this. I'd like to thank everybody for showing up, and let's continue the conversation informally. Thank you.